Originating in the Boston Mountains of Madison County, the Kings River meanders across the Ozark Plateau almost 90 miles before meeting Table Rock Lake on the Arkansas-Missouri border. Breathtaking views are found around every bend. Thousands of people visit the river each year to canoe, fish, and swim. Yet it remains just enough of a secret that you can still feel a sense of solitude and communion with nature that other, more crowded rivers have lost.
The Kings River is a blue ribbon smallmouth fishery, so it's got amazing fishing opportunity, so it's an awesome resource for anglers, but it is also a key canoeing destination for people all over the state. It's only second to the Buffalo River, National River. It is an outstanding resource. It has huge, beautiful bluffs, clean water, large gravel bars. It's kind of your, I guess, crown jewel of Arkansas rivers to go float and enjoy.
Not only is the Kings River a haven for wildlife and a beloved destination for people, it also contributes to drinking water supplies for dozens of communities in Arkansas and Missouri. That makes maintaining the river's water quality critical. One of the largest threats to the Kings River is sedimentation.
Sedimentation, you may ask, what does that matter? Gravel is a natural occurring process in rivers, and that's true. But what you really have to do is look at the history of the Ozarks and look at what happened in this actual watershed.
As the country expanded westward and people settled this area, the landscape changed. Large tracts of Ozark forests were logged and streamside land was cleared for pastures. That left few trees to hold the soil in place, and over the ensuing decades, erosion has sent large volumes of sediment into the river.
River systems are extremely resilient, meaning they are made to move gravel. They're made to, like, gravel bars are a natural process, but at the scales that we're seeing in our Ozark rivers, the river cannot handle it. And so what our job is to go in, identify the places that are most impacted and would make the biggest change in terms of sediment reduction to try to hit that tipping point to where the channel can actually adjust and become a resilient system that can handle all the gravel that's coming down.
We're trying to stop the unnatural erosion. All streams erode. What we're trying to fix is what we've actually caused, what we've increased the erosion to be. Sediment will kill out your macroinvertebrates, all your little bugs, your mayflies, sow bugs, and you have dragonfly larvae. All these dragonfly you see, they come out of our streams. When you start losing your macroinvertebrates, then your darters and your little bit bigger fish, your crayfish, they have nothing to eat on. Well, once those disappear, then your bigger fish that you actually want to catch are gone. Your smallmouth, which are, you know, that's what, you know, the Kings is known for smallmouth fishing.
Nature Conservancy has been interested in reducing sediment in the Kings River for a number of years. It's the number one problem for the biology of the Kings River. And so we started looking at what are the sources of sediment, and what we realized is a large amount of sediment is coming from the tributaries through some of the assessment work that we have done. And so we started looking at the tributaries and looking at opportunities to do restoration on these tributaries to stop the sources before they make it to the Kings River.
Rockhouse Creek is one of the major sediment offenders in the Kings River watershed. It has pushed rolling mounds of gravel to its mouth at the Kings River, although that wasn't the only problem.
So TNC's role in this project is we basically purchase the property that is adjacent to Rockhouse Creek that goes up about a mile and a half for the sole purpose of restoring Rockhouse Creek.
Just last year alone, we lost over 70 foot of the original channel. So that's 70 foot of bank that went into the Kings River. That equated to a lot of sediment.
It's got a fish passage barrier about half a mile upstream of the confluence, which prevents any fish from moving upstream and using this critical off-channel habitat. And probably the number one reason we chose this site specifically to do first is there's a safety problem, a public safety problem, because there's a low water slab crossing, which is extremely dangerous at high water, that crosses the Rockhouse Creek Road.
I live right next door to this property, and I had an incident at my house where a young woman came pounding on the door in the morning and needed medical assistance. So we called 911 and tried to get an EMT and the sheriff's out here, and the low water bridge was flooded and they couldn't get across. And it took quite a long time to coordinate to get Carroll County to come instead of Madison County because we live right on the border and we are technically in Madison County.
That opened up a partnership with the county road department because the bridge is damaged and it needed to be replaced and they needed to do something. So they were motivated to come into the program, and Game and Fish from a access perspective, because Rockhouse Access is just downstream, which is a major canoeing access point, canoeing, fishing access point for Game and Fish. So the cool thing is that this project, you know, had three main focal areas, which were public safety, the health of the Kings River from sediment reduction standpoint, and fish passage to open up a large amount of creek habitat that currently didn't exist.
The Nature Conservancy and Arkansas Game and Fish started construction on the Rockhouse Creek Restoration Project in October 2019. The team dug out 2,400 feet of new creek channel, planted 3,000 trees and shrubs to improve streamside habitat, and built a bridge to span the new channel. It was a major engineering and construction feat, but perhaps an even bigger accomplishment was pulling together project partners. The Nature Conservancy led the charge with help from Game and Fish, Madison County, adjacent landowners, the Southeast Aquatic Resources Partnership, Tyson Foods, and the outdoor apparel company Patagonia.
We basically moved the channel from where it was to a whole new location. So we've got about a half a mile of new stream, which didn't exist before. And so you may think, man, that is totally crazy. But because we had a dam that had backed up gravel behind it, and because there had been a lot of manipulation to the channel, dozing and straightening over time, the existing creek really didn't have a good form to be able to make a restoration happen. Also, we looked at the cost and economics of if we had restored it in the existing channel versus moving it. It actually turned out to be cheaper to move it, which is kind of hard to believe. We would have had to import dirt in to build banks to make it a stable system. So just the earthwork and the cost to do that would have cost more than to do what we did, which was actually move the channel. They call this, in restoration terms, it's called a priority one restoration. And you don't see them very often because you have to have a lot of space. You have to have a floodplain adjacent to it that you can move the channel. When we do these priority one restorations, we bring the channel back into its historical floodplain and re-meander it to where the banks are low enough to where at flood flow it disperses across the landscape, reduces all of that velocity, so it basically helps everyone downstream as well.
Being that it was a priority one, which is a rare project, it doesn't happen that often in Arkansas, we were able to do all this in the dry in the hayfield, which is something that is, you just don't get to do that very often. You're normally working in the wetted creek. But we started at the upper end and we left it blocked off. We had a dam there blocking it off where it couldn't get in the hayfield. And we started up there and just worked downstream. And as we dug the channel out where it went, we were actually installing the root wads and the rock structures.
The creek channel was moved, but the new course was also improved by including design elements that mimicked natural stream ecology.
It's an amazing project to be a part of from a restoration standpoint, because a lot of times you're just band-aid, you know, you're trying to fix a bank or you're trying to do this, but you hardly ever get the artistic license to go in and create a new stream channel. And we didn't do this willy-nilly and just drawing squiggles on paper. We used a really developed method called natural channel design, where you basically find a stream that's working, preferably the same stream, upstream is what we did, and you figure out what the dimensions are, the curvature, the radius, the curvature, and all of the different things that make a stream, and you mimic that and build that on your landscape. And so that's what you're seeing here. But what that does is it ensures that it's going to be stable because we have a model that's stable to work from, and that's what's called natural channel design.
The design included installing about 700 tons of large rock structures and more than 2,000 cedar tree root wads. Crews also planted native vegetation all around the site.
We need vegetation on the stream banks because that's what's keeping the stream banks in place. We noticed in areas where that woody vegetation has been removed, those areas are the most susceptible to erosion. So in this case, where we've reconstructed a stream channel in the pasture, we've pretty much started with a blank slate. So our target is to get this the stream banks and surrounding floodplain vegetated so that in the long term you come out and you see forests on there. So we don't want people to come and see our project and it look like people have come out and installed rocks and wood and all that. We want people to come out in the future and see trees and shrubs so it looks natural.
The project was completed in February 2020.
Now there's more water for fish species, there's more water for macroinvertebrates, and there's more habitat. We were able to open up fish passage and there's less sediment going into the Kings River. So it's a win-win overall.
To be able to go from a concept where you're driving by and looking at a section of creek which looks like there's nothing you could do to fix it and be able to restore it to a way that is not only, you know, aesthetically beautiful for people, but it works extremely well as habitat for fish, and it just feels good. Like if you sit down by this creek and you listen to it, it gives you a really positive feeling. And so to be a part of a project like that where you can actually do a restoration instead of maybe patchwork stabilization is really I'm at a loss for words at how amazing it makes me feel.